Once again, you know what time it is, live from the Resource Center with your host, Be Free. I'm back in the building, and I'm in the building along with my co-pilot, co-host, Will McKee. What's going on, brother? Talk to me.
Hey, Ben, what's going on? Great evening. Great to be with you. Great time in this world right now. Looking forward to a great show.
No doubt. We got some stuff we're going to cover today. You know, before we get into it, I just want to say you can catch us on social media, Facebook. You can go to the Live from the Resource Center Facebook page, which we had when we were just doing the Blog Talk radio show. Now, obviously, we're vlogging, but you can also catch the RCB store on Facebook and social media platforms. We also have a blog site now, Live from the RC.net, where we're putting out some good info. We also post along with good articles and write some of our teams. Check it out. It's there for just, you know, a resource. So you want to vent on something, talk about something, maybe find a different perspective to help you with something, that's the spot to go, Live from the RC.net. So that being said, Brother McKee, I hope our technological difficulties will work itself out. We've been having some troubles, but we're going to push through because that's what we do. So with that being said, let's jump right into it. This is a big weekend that we're recording on because right now it's Saturday. Hopefully you'll see this pretty soon in the middle of the week, but it will already have been played. But it is Super Bowl weekend, with the Super Bowl, which will be played tomorrow, Sunday, February 3rd, in the ATL between the Los Angeles Rams and, once again, the New England Patriots. You know, Brother McKee, the Patriots are back again. It's like they're always in the Super Bowl. And I'm going to get your take on the Super Bowl as a whole, because, you know, we usually go a little more in depth. But right now, let me, instead of just going into the pick, let me just say it like this. Do the Rams have a legitimate chance tomorrow? Talk to me.
I think it was Keenan Ivory Wayans who said it's the Rams that's in trouble. So and that's back when they really were in trouble. Mm-hmm. But I think the Rams have a puncher's chance. A prolific offense, North Carolina zone, Mr. Gurley in the backfield. So I think the Rams have a good enough defense and a prolific enough offense to win the Super Bowl. Everybody knows what they're up against is the giant, the bully in the schoolyard, a.k.a. what has now become America's most hated team.
Yeah.
It used to be arguably the Dallas Cowboys. Either you love them or you hate them. They have been replaced by these New England Patriots. So to answer your question, I think the Rams have a chance. This is not a one-sided matchup by far. It's just that when you're going up against I call them the de facto champ because even though they didn't win the Super Bowl last year, they've won it so many times, we know, that anytime they make it to the promised land, it's expected for them to win. And that other team has to prove themselves.
You're right. You're right. Let me ask this. Going back to that point, because it's kind of like they expected to win or at least expected to get there. Like, no matter where they finish in the AFC standings, it's like it still goes through New England. Like, you always feel like they have a shot. So tell me this. Is that good for pro football, or is it hurting the game when you have the dominant and let me make this point. And I ask that because the way the structures of contracts and everything goes with the NFL, you know, it's not set up for you to have dynasties, so speak. Like, that really falls on your management to really keep that consistency for those long periods of time. Like, most people tell you the way it's set up, you know, it's set up maybe for teams to make 4 or 5 year runs, but then, you know, the way the deals and restructuring and everything, you know, it's kind of meant for people to go seek other opportunities or let people go for, you know, the cap space or whatever, or, you know, franchise tags. So, you know, it's remarkable in that sense that New England has pretty much been able to do this since about 2000, 2001. So, does it hurt it or help it? McKee, I'll yield to you.
Yeah, and the way you asked the question, I know you got an opinion on that too, with your vast years of athletic experience, coaching, and the like. That's the question that's always asked when you have a team in any sport that emerges as a perennial contender or champion. Let me say this about the New England Patriots, and this is tough on us, Ben, because as you said, by the time this airs, we're going to know who the winner is. So we'll either look like prophets or fools. But the New England Patriots, much has been said about some of the so-called corners that they were trying to cut, whether it be as the Migos, hashtag Migos, from the North, that way, ATL. They put it in one of those songs, take the air out the ball, Bill Belichick. then they said, take the air out the mall, like when they show up, right?
Yeah.
So much has been said about Deflategate and some a situation where there was some film that got out that was not supposed to be out, recording another team's practice. But aside of that, you have to respect anybody who goes to the big dance and wins it that many times. This combination of Belichick and Brady, mind you, was not the pick of the litter in his draft. He's a testament to what can happen when somebody dedicates themselves to the game, works hard, observes their diet. You know, and you got to beat the Patriots between those lines. And, you know, I don't think we've ever seen a coach that's able to put a defensive scheme together. And I come from a household with my father loved defensive schemes and stunts and mixing up your blitz package and saying, I'm going to take this player out of the game because he's the player that's killing everybody, that's hurting everybody. I'm going to take them out and make them beat me somewhere else. Bill Belichick does that better than anybody ever has. So whoever the Rams have been going to in previous weeks, look for Belichick to take that element away.
Yes.
And somebody else has got to step up. Now, I think the Rams have enough to supplant whatever Belichick takes away. But to answer your question, you know, the Rams, I mean, the Patriots have done it on the field, and you've got to respect. They bring new players in. As you said, the trade rules are not structured for dynasties anymore. That's a great point. But there's something about these players when they get to New England.
Yes.
They turn into relentless beasts. Yes. They play like they came from Boise State.
I knew Boise State was going to make it in there somehow with Brother Will. Boise
State is not who you want to play on a Friday night up in Idaho. So Belichick is able to psychologically penetrate the brains of his players, and he matches that with sound strategic defense. And he's been able to create a hospitable relationship with his superstar quarterback. They've managed that relationship well. Nobody's gotten greedy. Nobody said, I want out, or I want to be featured. He fosters a team concept. And he rotates players. And can we be remiss if we left out Edelman? You're talking about a relentless wide receiver that may not have what some people would draw up on the draft board as the qualities that you want to pick necessarily with some of the attributes that general managers have been going after. But yet, Belichick sees something in these players, and he likes their grit. And he says, I'm going to put you in the best situation to do what you do best. And he's a genius at that. I don't care if you like him or not. You got to beat the Patriots between those lines on that field. And that's what the Rams are going to have to do.
No doubt. And brilliant points, because that goes right to my next or the next part of that question or statement. To bring guys in. And getting a good friends like cats, like the ultimate you know, he's brought some guys that still, like, you would think they would they, you know what I'm saying? It's like you come in and this chance to be a part of this machine. We're not leaning on you to bring us here. We're already here. So it's your choice if you want to be successful to buy into us, rather than sometimes when we see certain signings and stuff of players who's trying to bring us up. You see what I'm saying? And with that luxury, it's like, no, Tom Brady's our superstar. Now, we still handle him how we handle, you know, but he's our superstar, and we're going to put cats that want to play for this culture and play with one of the greatest as well. And then we come back and we put together a stellar defense that, you know, is just always prepared. Even when it looks like, man, they bend, don't break. And it's tough, McKee. It's tough. Because I can't stand the Patriots, but I got to give them respect and show them love. I you know, if for anything, you enjoy the Super Bowl because you want to see them get beat. or either say, well, they win another one. But shout out to and the New England. Shout out to you. Congratulations on making it to another Super Bowl. But I will be rooting for the Rams, but, you know, more props to you for being and just a staple. And honestly, I think it doesn't hurt football because like the movie stated, any given Sunday, you know, a team can come up, spring up, and win the thing. You know, we didn't think Philly was going to do it the way they did last year, but so, excuse me, you know, so I think it hurt like with the women's basketball team. You like, oh Lord, but they lost the other night. Shout out to was it not? I can't remember, but you know, I think it helps though. But transitioning to that there is always a big month because number one, in the NBA, we're approaching right before the All-Star break, and there's a lot more meals. People are making bids to get Anthony Davis after he got fined for saying, I want to be traded. I don't know how you find people for just saying what they feel, unless he said something in an interview or something. You know what I mean? Now, if he just went to management like, hey, I want out, I don't know how you find somebody. But anyway, but All-Star weekend is coming up, and it's going to go down in the wonderful state of North Carolina, Charlotte, North Carolina, to be exact, at the Spectrum Arena. I know we're excited for that in the state, and hopefully we can get down and maybe participate in some of the functions live from the Resource Center. We'll try to be on the scene. But and Brother McKee, you actually have a connection to those that help bring it to Charlotte, and we'll be overseeing that. So you might want to go into that, but well, we all kind of have a connection. Talk about NBA All-Star game coming to Charlotte finally after we had to wait an extra year. But talk about that, man, and tell us how you feel.
Yeah, great setup. You know, we've waited a long time. You talk about the state of North Carolina and pro sports. This is a fairly new phenomenon still for our state, North and South Carolina. We waited a long time to get the Carolina Panthers, to get the Charlotte Hornets. And for years, people in this region, in football, you rooted for the Washington Redskins, a few for the Atlanta Falcons, and a whole lot of people for Dallas. And in basketball, you just kind of rooted for whomever because we just didn't have pro sports in this state. So we waited a long time to get sports in pro sports in general. We've waited even longer to have an All-Star game come to the state. Now, you know, this most recently, the All-Star game, as you stated, was delayed because of the HB2 legislation that was moved through the General Assembly here in North Carolina. And that had to be ironed out. And big credit to Mr. Fred Whitfield, who your dad coached in Little League here in Greensboro, North Carolina, was one of his early mentors. He credits a lot of what he knows and does to your dad, Ken Free, senior former MEAC commissioner and pro baseball player. And just so happens, as fate would have it, they happened to be my next door neighbors growing up. We shared the same backyard. So I was able to grow up to see the likes of Michael Jordan in our backyard as Fred Whitfield was a mentor and a good friend to Michael Jordan. And after Fred went to law school and got his MBA, he became Michael's business partner, of which he now is the president of the Charlotte Hornets. And you can't mention Fred without mentioning the dynamic duo, Batman and Robin. That's Charles Whitfield, who went into the music partnership of the music business with Michael Jordan and Hidden Beach Recordings. And we know Jill Scott, Anthony Hamilton, and the like. So Charlotte is going to be lit.
Yeah.
To borrow the nomenclature of the younger generation, Charlotte is going to be lit this weekend. And so shout out to the Whitfield family for staying steadfast and bringing that here. You know, I think minority businesses, and you didn't ask me this, but I'm going to throw it in because it's the resource. Come on.
That's what we talk do. About
community resources. We've got to make sure that minority businesses, for example, get their seat at the table. We had a long discussion about that in the previous show about the CIAA tournament and fairness and equity coming off the heels of King Holiday, of how minority businesses must be at the table. Of course, providing quality services, but we cannot allow the All-Star game, NBA, hopefully playoff games one day, to be in the region without minority businesses getting in on the ground floor and using this as a windfall for everybody, for everybody. What are your thoughts about the All-Star game being in the Queen City?
Well, like you said, we waited a long time for this, and I think with the growth of Charlotte and I think it encourages the sell some hats, some incense, whatever. We're gonna try to throw a party, do something.
Right, right.
I think that's the key, because even and I'll be on a funny conversation. I was down last for a friend. We did a little surprise birthday bash. Cause we finally reached the hill, you know, ain't gonna give my age now, but, I had a birthday bash and, you know, it was a good collection of brothers, some more familiar with others than that. But you know, even then, and just hanging out, enjoying time with one another, enjoying, what was going on, the establishments, and enjoying downtown Charlotte. You know, one of the brothers who actually is working with an NBA team in marketing kind of brought up like, hey, man, you know, we have a good group of brothers. We get along, man. Why don't we just put something together and prepare for All-Star next week? And I think that's what we have to capitalize on. In these things. If we plan the party and do stuff, why not, instead of the 300 on the bar and Uber and food, and, you know, why don't we take 100? Because I definitely don't spend that much on it. But, you know, you get the principal party, you know, if we're going to get a telly or whatever, why not put that together and benefit from it? Because we know that in a city of and county of 1 million people already, then with the people from the areas coming around throughout North Carolina, South Carolina, probably from Virginia, have a chance to be. So it's like, that's where we have to take advantage of these type of events. To whereas, even if the city doesn't support, sometimes we have to be innovative and really just go for art. You know what I'm saying? Even if it's, let's get a towers and do a day party. I have a friend that's a DJ. Let's block it off, make some flyers up, pass to the block party. We do that, you know, it has to spark. Who can't, the standalone or the, but has that entrepreneurial spirit, and hopefully it creates new things to pop up around there. But, you know, I hope that fit in, but also, like I say, you know, in events like this, you're going to need added security, added traffic control. So it also people opportunities that might be doing temp work or just lost a job. You know, while we don't know what's going to be going on 15th, might say, hey, I can make extra money to help my family this week, parking cars, doing stuff. So it also helps the local maybe get an opportunity to make some money that might help them through something or start something. So I think that's big too, as well as the impact with your local young folks connecting with the NBA and the partnerships, because they do a lot of stay in school and you know, so it's big on all levels. It's just, you know, let's make sure waiting for something, take advantage of it while it's there in any way. And you have to be creative. So, you know,
gotta be creative. Name your incense. For example, change your incense names to NBA players' names. What used to be Black Love, it could be Durant Love this year. But seriously though, big shout out to Adam Silver and the NBA staff, because they've done, I think you've mentioned this on several occasions, they've done a great job where the NFL has had some cultural competency problems. Or understanding their players' issues. The NBA, to its credit, has been very socially conscious, as you stated, very committed to education, from LeBron James on down, you know. But yeah, we do want to stress too that, you know, this is a live, like you say all the time, this is live from the Resource Center, and this is a $45 million weekend coming up. And folks in all communities should reap a windfall from that. And to do that, you've got to, we also got to be, have our radar up and create opportunities, as you just said, block your street off, be creative with your merchandise. There's a ton of things that can be done too, bottom up as well. But big shout out to Charlotte. We're looking for a great, great weekend in the Carolinas.
No doubt. But remember, we're live from the Resource Center. We have the page, Facebook, or the RCB store. Check out the blog site, www.livefromthrc.net. Check us out. Remember, the resources, you know, it's there. Sometimes you just need help accessing it. Yes, and we are back live from the Resource Center. It's your boy Be Free, along with my co-pilot, Brother Will McKee. Will McKee, at this time, let everybody know who our special sponsor for today, or this episode, is of Live from the Resource Center.
Yes, Ben, today's show is sponsored by Victorious Visions. Yes. Victorious Visions, where their motto is art is everything and everything is art. Victorious Visions, we can take care of all of your arts needs: murals, face painting, airbrush, football fields, line stripping, art camps, art parties. Contact us, Victorious Visions, 2216 West Meadowview Road, Suites 101 and 102, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27410. Their telephone number is 336-543-0222. That's 336-543-0222. Victorious Visions, where art is everything and everything is art.
No doubt. Shout out to the owner, operator, visionary, Brother James Raleigh, for doing his thing over there at Victorious Visions.
Yes.
And we appreciate him. So great first segment. So this segment, we're going to kind of flip the script, get to the political side of things. Not too in depth, because like I say, we just try to give some information, just discuss some topics and get into stuff. But one thing that stood out to me that I realized after, you know, I saw the announcement for Cory Booker to run for president. And I looked at the whole scheme of things, and I looked at all the Democrats who are making their announcements to run for presidency in 2020. And one thing I noticed, McKee, was how diverse this group of Democrats is that are planning to run against Donald Trump, who has filed his papers for re-election. And I was like, whoa. Like, it just hit me, like, would we have seen this much diversity 4-8 years ago? Or let me change that. Would we have seen this type of diversity before 08? Because there is a plethora of candidates that are running from various backgrounds, nationality wise, ethnically wise, culturally, socially. And so my question came to say, is this a part of the Obama effect? Because we really didn't see this in 2016. Or is this a rush because we're not pleased with who we have presently in the White House? So everybody's like, now is my time. And not to knock the president, but also, you know, he didn't come from a very political background. Now, most of the Democratic constituents are have political backgrounds, but just to say, he came more from a business background. So did that play a role in opening the door for others to say, hey, well, I have knowledge of running a business and doing things and management. Maybe I have a passion for politics. You know, did that play a role in it too? But McKee, I want to know, is this some of the Obama effect? Because having the first president elected that was of non-European descent, or African-American descent, if you want to say, is it a product of that more are having confidence? And I'm just saying gender-wise, socially, ethnically, you know, all facets, or is this you know, this is our time because we're not pleased with what's going on with our nation type thing. Talk to me.
Oh, that's a good question,
Ben. And I'm going to go through some of the candidates, too.
Okay.
If people look like, why I said that, but go ahead.
Right. Good question. And so we have a plethora of candidates. And it's almost easier to name who's not running.
Yeah.
because I'm probably looking at some of the same stuff you're looking at where they got the, anytime you got the top 15 ranked, yeah. And that's not all of them, winnowing down who, because, so to answer your first question, I think that the Obama era has definitely playing a role when you see a first, a modern first, when you see a history made, everybody observing, and even folks from demographics or racial backgrounds or gender backgrounds that didn't think previously really that it could happen. Once mm-hmm. Obama breaks that glass ceiling, now everybody raises up and sees that it's possible. So yes, President Obama and Michelle have a role in a diverse body of people feeling like they too could win. I think President Trump has a role in a diverse body of people running because in a different way, he was an unlikely winner.
Yeah.
Not politically connected, never run for office, never held an office, and he won. So that also sends a signal that if you can gain momentum and win the battleground states, yeah. And I think what the Democrats have to focus on, some people say, well, how will you narrow the candidates down because everybody's running? And yeah, it does seem like everybody's running. Word on the street is that you were going to announce on today's show that you were running. It's an hour show, so maybe that's coming too. Everybody else is running.
Yeah.
But, yeah. I think, you know, just briefly, one of the ways that I think the field kind of gets narrowed is we have to understand that Hillary Clinton won the popular vote. That gets lost sometimes. She got the most votes in the country, but she did not win the Electoral College. Mm-hmm. And so we know the battleground states, there are many, but the three big ones, the big three, we know are Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania. So I think the Democrats would be wise at seeing who plays the best in those Rust Belt states. And when you think of Rust Belt, this is not to count Kamala Harris or anybody else out, but you know the Joe Bidens come to mind. Someone who hasn't declared, Senator Sherrod Brown, comes to mind. And even Aunt Elizabeth Warren, who is kind of has a populist, has championed populist causes. And there's a lot of working class folks out there that even though they may be employed, are finding out that it takes two or three jobs to make ends meet when in years past you could get a job at the General Motors plant in Flint, Michigan, for example, and send your children to college. Can't do that so much now. So those big three battleground states are going to really narrow the field, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. And then we'll kind of separate the contenders from the pretenders. And I'll just say also that a noted political scientist once said that you campaign in poems, but you govern in prose. So the best poet is going to be probably the winner. The best poet that has the least skeletons in the closet. And that usually comes best.
Put some Stevie on here. Skeletons in your closet.
Yeah, hey, what does your mama tell you about lies?
Yeah.
And so, you know, once you emerge as a front runner, everybody gets the shovels out on the opponent side and they start digging. And, you know, Kamala Harris has launched a good early campaign, distinguished herself, but she was a state's attorney general. So she has a lot to pick from. Yeah. From the opposition. She's made some rulings and some decisions that have left her for scrutiny. Yeah. You know, the governor's position has been a great way to emerge to be the president, and also from the U.S. Senate, which kind of incubates you from kind of being exposed when you're a senator. being that the Senate is called the saucer that cools off the hot beverage of the House of Representatives. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be an exciting field, to say the least. And we'll live from the Resource Center. I know we'll be watching this race and letting the viewers know how we see it.
Well, and that's great points. Great points. And that's key. And I know from what I've seen, I know Cory Booker is taking that approach, like job creation, getting people to work, which will be big. But let me go through this list and point out the diversity. You've got Cory Booker, African American male. Julian Castro from San Antonio, whose parents are of Mexican nationality. Tulsi Gabbard, who is a House U.S. Rep from Hawaii, but Samoan background, and also a woman. Kamala Harris, who is a woman who's her parents are actually, I believe, West Indies. People tried to question her, but she was born in the States. But she is not to get down to the nitty gritty, African American woman. Elizabeth Warren, she's got an exploratory committee out that she did on New Year's Eve. She hasn't officially been announced, but people are thinking she may. Andrew Yang, an entrepreneur from New York, applied back in 2017. They're saying some potentials. There's rumors, and maybe she's waiting to see after she gets, you know, after she makes her response to the State of the Union address. But they're thinking Stacey Abrams may even throw her hat in the race. And let me, you said Sherrod Brown, and let me throw out one more, and there's several other women, but even with, from Indiana, Peter Buttigieg, I hope I said his name, Buttigieg, he's a young guy, mayor of South Bend, Indiana, shout out to the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame, but he's openly gay. So you actually have someone who is LGBTQ who is putting their hat in the race. So I just think it's very unique, like the diversity of these groups or these individuals that are running for the top position in the land, in the world. Mm-hmm. And there's no fear or no doubt. I do think it's powerful, especially when you see that many women running. And I think that's partly, you know, because Hillary, you know, she won the popular vote, so she had a successful run, so speak, the strongest chance, I guess, at the time. Is what I'm trying to say, but now it's like, hey, push the pedal to the metal and let's go all out. You know, now we have a shot. We're at a time where people need, you know, we're looking for change, you know, and that started, I guess you could say, in 08 with Obama, and that was the mantra, and a change for the better. Like you said, and all the points you made on how to get it done. But, you know, I like the diversity we have, because that just shows the type of nation that we're changing into. And I think that's powerful going forward. But on that, I mean, I just wanted to point that out, whether it be the Obama effect, Hillary effect, or where we are as a country. I think it's a sign of a diverse future for this nation. So, and Brother McKee, I know you're a political scientist. Insight on any others you think might throw a hat in? I know you mentioned Joe Biden. Brown, Warren, like do you think they will throw their hat in the race?
I think it's very possible. Even people like former Virginia Governor Terry McAuliffe. You might have mentioned Michael Bloomberg. I don't know, former New York mayor.
Okay. Yeah.
And so there are some other folks, and even some people that we obviously wouldn't think about that are going to surprise everybody. Kind of piggybacking off something else you said, I would just encourage, kind of in a live from the Resource Center way, that the voters just go around, be very clear on what policy that you want to see come into fruition, and not be so much driven by the personality of the candidate, but their past track record. If they've been in elected office, see how they voted and line that up with your interest. That's what I'll be doing. You know, in years past, I think it was former President Bill Clinton that stated, "It's the economy, stupid." And that was kind of a statement he coined because people were mentioning all these different issues that may define the election that he first ran. And he kind of told everybody, "It's the economy, stupid." He suggested that people care more about anything, how their job security is. How much food does their dollar purchase? Can they take the vacation? Is college tuition priced beyond their means? So if this economy holds strong going into this next presidential election, I think if the economy dips in any substantial way, President Trump is in big trouble. Some yeah. people suggest that he's already in big trouble because of his decorum. Hey, I get that, but he has a base that's still there, not to be underestimated, particularly in those battleground states. It's not the whole country all the time. It's those battleground states. Just want to say real briefly, though, if the, you know, and we've got some, as Dr. King said, we've got some tough days ahead. We have a Mueller investigation that is going to reveal something. If the Mueller investigation is a whole lot about nothing, then Donald Trump can tout that as the biggest victory, and I told you so, in American history. If the Mueller report comes back with some serious indictments, then this presidential race may be decided by that.
Yeah.
Because he may become so toxic to other leading Republicans that everybody abandons. So there's the Mueller case coming down. And there's also, so we have a lot of things between now and then those surprise factors. But yeah. if the economy holds up and is still strong, and past research by everybody shows that that's what people are most likely to vote about, it's lining up to be another very unpredictable and interesting elections if the economy is strong. And the Democrats will be banking on the fact that the president's decorum and the polarized language that he's using, which is unconventional of previous presidents, that's the kind of race you're going to have to run if you're Democrats, if the economy's strong.
Yeah.
And we all know those folks out there that supported President Obama give him a huge portion of the credit in getting the economy back on track. All the indicators had an uptick under the Obama administration when it came to jobs and the unemployment rate, but it has certainly continued to rise under President Trump. So a strong economy, a lackluster report from Robert Mueller that doesn't reveal much, just brings more questions forth. That makes for a very interesting. And so the Democrats being are debating internally, what kind of race do we run against President Trump? Because one of the tough things about running against President Trump is you don't put dirt out on President Trump. He puts it out there in advance.
Yeah.
he has been the most forthcoming president with what he will do, no matter how bombastic it is. It's hard to outstartle him because he's going to tweet something tomorrow that's going to trump what you can say. So yeah. Cory Booker is kind of looking at running a candidacy that does not take him on directly. He's kind of banking on the fact that the country is looking for love.
Yeah.
And hopefully in all the right places with him.
Yeah.
But then you have Kamala Harris and some others that say, take him on head on.
Yeah.
So the strategy becomes tricky this go round, but we'll see.
And before I touch on one more thing on those points, do you think, and once again, y'all, Brother McKee is a political scientist. that's why I'm picking him right now. Do you think that there will be anyone from the Republican Party? Because there have been several that have kind of disconnected. Do you think there'll be anybody in the Republican Party that might say, you know what, I want a challenge just to kind of change the pace of this thing? Or do you think they'll just let it run its course? What's your thoughts on that?
That's a great question. I think Trump gets a contender in the Republican Party based upon Robert Mueller's report.
Okay, yeah.
I think there are some folks sitting back behind the scenes waiting to see what the Mueller report reveals and uncovers, because if you have a president who's the president's men and the president's women, if they're all under indictment and like a runway at Kennedy Airport, if the House subcommittees are lining up Trump cabinet members for House hearings for obstruction of justice, all the things that the Mueller report may be accusatory of the president's men and women are, if those hearings are lined up one by one and they're not looking good, and it even gets up to the Oval Office, then I think you see several contenders emerge for a Republican primary. I think you do. If the Mueller report, as I said earlier, doesn't really reveal much more than we know, I think the president goes unopposed and takes on the Democratic victor. So I think the Mueller report is going to govern whether or not there's a Republican challenger.
And I kind of feel that. I kind of feel that as well. But just going into platforms as we wind the show down, man, we've been rolling. I know you mentioned approaches. And I want your thoughts on this, because this was one of the things that was big when Obama was running. So I'm going to address it now for my peoples. How do they approach those candidates of color? The African-American community,
right?
Because it's like, you danged if you do, you danged if you don't. And you know, shout out to brother Roland Martin Unfiltered. Love it. But he's one that's very like, hey, come see me so you can really get your points out to the black, because this show is for us, about us and our issues. But I know sometimes candidates might feel, well, I can't be, let's just be real, I can't be too black because it might scare off some of those that aren't familiar with a diverse platform. Let me just say it like that. Did I do that okay?
You did.
In some of those, yeah, in some of those areas. For instance, I know Cory Booker was in Iowa.
Yeah.
Doing some campaigning, some early campaigning and stuff. And I know it's like, I know they want to, but I know it's a fine line, but is there a method, or should we kind of say, hey, maybe we should just try to see what works for us in the general sense and get these people into these positions? And then we say, all right, come sit at the table. Or do we just right from the gate, hey, this is what you got to do for us to get you in there? Is there a method, and what's the best approach in your opinion?
Wow, that is a great question. And there's already been talk about how the African-American candidates in this field are already sounding much different than President Obama sounded when he ran. And, President Obama tended to not address race head on unless he had to.
Yeah.
And, you know, his strategy was, and it goes back to his speech at the Democratic convention that kind of sprung him onto the American stage, where he said, it's not the red states, it's not the blue states, there's the United States of America. I'm paraphrasing that. Mm-hmm. And so he decided to do a unifying message, which was very effective, as we see. Winning two terms. This field of candidates are saying, hey, I'm African-American, and I'm unapologetically that, and they're speaking to those issues. So, you know, the jury's still out. I got an op-ed piece that I'm going to upload to your blog site, Ben, and shout out to you, just like you shouted out Roland Martin, who's an awesome journalist. Shout out to you for your new blog site. And relaunching the Live from the Resource Center show as well. I got an op-ed piece that I'm going to put on there called The Algorithmless Nation, playing off of Janet Jackson's old song, and a column that Van Jones of CNN wrote about how we all get the news feeds that we like based on an algorithm of our online choices.
Yeah.
So we don't cross-pollinate issues as much anymore because of the information age with technology. Just one quick point. For example, talked about the Mueller probe and the Russia investigation where the president is allegedly linked to. I just saw something on the Gallup organization that does the Gallup poll where they said the Russia investigation receives an importance rating, meaning this, how much is this important? Mm-hmm. Receives an importance rating of 66% from Democrats. So we see Democrats see the Mueller probe and the Russian investigation as very important.
Mm-hmm.
But get this, versus 19% from the Republicans.
Wow.
Republican voters only see the Mueller probe as 19% of their electorate see this as even important. So the Mueller probe doesn't really matter to Trump's base. So Democrats have to understand that he was going to hold his base no matter what Robert Mueller comes back
with
his findings.
Yeah.
And, you know, if he gets indicted and there's a trial, then of course he's in trouble. But just by, you know, the limited powers of a special prosecutor and things of that, like going back to a Kenneth Starr-like indictment, you know, it doesn't really affect Trump's base. So, you know, the way the African-American candidates position themselves in the primaries, it's about getting the Democratic voter out.
Yeah.
And if you're blessed to be the lone person standing, now you've got to have an expanded message that plays well in Iowa, as you stated. The so-called flyover states. They're called that because most people fly over those states and go from New York to L.A. or to Houston or to Chicago. You fly over Iowa. Well, if you don't have a good showing in Iowa, then you get off to a bad start.
Yeah.
So people in middle America matter.
Yeah. Hey, man, powerful stuff. And we'll get more into it as more announcements come. And because one thing, you know, I'm passionate about now more so is the understanding of the power of local government and politics, what mostly affects you. Sometimes we get caught up in the popularity of the U.S. election, because it does affect us and our country where we stand amongst the world. But essentially, sometimes what gets lost is the local factor, which funds your schools, funds your communities, brings in opportunities, who's chiefly responsible for bringing in opportunities to your state, your city, your county, whatever. And one thing we've got to wake people up, because when I look at the numbers for certain local elections and stuff, it's like, whoa, we're missing the picture because we're waiting on the big things, which is important. But also, we need to understand the power of your local government, because that's what mostly affects you. But with that being said, Brother McKee, you got any last shout outs, anything you want to lift up before we break out of here, brother?
I just want to shout out. Thank you to the listeners. And hopefully this show has been a resource to you as you get ready to enjoy the Super Bowl that will have happened by the time we get on.
Well, you know what? The producers have been in my ear, even though I don't have a earpiece or nothing on. they've been in my ear saying we might press to try to get this out by Sunday afternoon. A special edition episode.
If that's able to happen, that'd be great as well. Yeah. But just a shout out to, just one shout out to, if you want to talk to me, you can reach me on Twitter at McKee Mediation on Twitter. That's at McKee Mediation on Twitter. Shout out to the listeners. Thank you for tuning in. And thank you, Ben.
Yes. And I want to shout you, brother, for doing it a phenomenal job once again, co-piloting with me. And we will get it up when we edit all your information, brother. But for immediate access to the show, we're going to get it loaded up on the blog site at livefromthrc.net. You can check it out. And like I say, we got some great posts up there. And we'll tweet it out and get it out as well, and get it out on Facebook. So check us out, live in the Resource Center, the RCB store, McKee Mediation. We're going to get it to you. But shout out. Thank you. And, you know, as I always say, you know, grace and peace, and just stay powerful. All right. And we'll catch you next time. To Fangus, we out.